More towns are now facing the fury of the Riverina floods.
As we go to air tonight, more severe weather is on its way with warnings of flash flooding for Sydney, and we'll get the latest from Tim Bailey in just a moment. But TENS reporters are also across the flood zone. Melinda Nusifora is in Wagga Wagga. Mazoe Ford has spent the day in the hard-hit hamlet of Lockhart. And Gabby Boyle's with the folk in Forbes, anxiously watching the water rise. But the most serious emergency tonight is in the town of Griffith.
And there, 16,000 residents have been cut off by the raging Murrumbidgee River. Many hundreds ordered to flee their homes in the dead of night. The town centre is now awash, causing havoc to businesses and damage that no one is brave enough to estimate just yet. The town is built on a massive irrigation area, and the SES fears that could remain flooded for weeks.
In that area, it's an unprecedented flood event, and a large number of people have been evacuated in the last 24 hours.
Those who could have queued for fuel and stocked up on supplies, emptying local supermarkets. Plans are now being made to restock the town and reach those in outlying areas.
Well, the state's largest inland city, Wagga Wagga, has been spared the knockout blow that so many of us had feared. Mel Nusifora is there for us tonight. Mel, it's still a pretty sorry picture there right now, though, isn't it?
Sandra, the levee may not have burst here in Wagga Wagga, but the town is still well and truly not out of the woods yet. It's going to take many, many weeks for this floodwater to fully recede. In just a number of days, the SES have received more than 3,500 calls for help and performed 140 dangerous flood rescues. The water is receding, but the crisis is far from over. Houses at the Rock are now just shells, 2 metre floodwaters washing away what made them homes.
My heart goes out to the ones here in North Wagga.
Wagga Wagga residents have watched the Murrumbidgee River rise for days, but last night, a sigh of relief. The flood peak was revised down, the town's levee bank held, and by morning, evacuation orders for most areas were lifted.
They are now free to return to their homes as an all clear is now issued.
For the first time in days, business owners are returning to Wagga's CBD. They've escaped the floodwaters, but are still counting the costs.
All these sandbags have got to be moved, and then we've got to get in and clean and put everything back and try and get some food from somewhere.
But on the north side of town, the situation is very different. This is the first time this couple have seen their home. They're not even sure how much of it is left.
It's the second time we've been in floods in 2 years. 2010 we was in it, now this one. This one's higher.
This is the start of what is going to be many, many, many long months of recovery.
The Prime Minister got a bird's eye view today of why hundreds of locals still have nowhere to go. Wagga Wagga residents aren't the only ones who've been scrambling for higher ground. Thousands and thousands of tiny spiders have come in search of higher ground and have spun webs right across the flooded plains. As the floodwaters move downstream, the emergency travels with them. The Westpac rescue helicopter winched a man to safety this morning. He was found clinging to a tree after his car was swept away by the torrent.
It's not just Wagga Wagga that's been affected here. There are many outlying towns that have also been swamped by these floodwaters. Mazoe Ford today travelled to Lockhart, a town of about 900 people, and most of them have been hit hard.
This is our lounge room. And as you can see, it's got a little bit more destruction.
A heartbreaking tour of a home and business destroyed.
Which was hard because that's very sentimental to me, but sorry.
June and Darrell Wade own the Lockhart Roadhouse and live behind it. Flooding ruined it first in 2010, and water has returned with a vengeance.
We just finished these boards 2 weeks ago from the last flood.
There is some good news. June managed to save these.
Some beautiful photos there, some great memories that you've saved.
Oh no, because I lost my mum last year, so that's, you know.
And unlike last time, they have a place to stay in their retirement project.
It'll do us for now. It's at least we're able to stay here at our site.
And this creek was the culprit. A week ago it was completely dry, and then the rain came and the water rose to the bank here. That was Saturday morning. By Saturday night, it had flowed right across the backyard and into the back of June and Darrell's place. There are homes and businesses all over Lockhart cleaning up. Today at last, help could get in, and rural firees arrived en masse. A tiny town far away but not forgotten. And to those who live here, a town forgiven.
I suppose our love of Lockhart, not love of Lockhart's love of us, that'll keep us going at the end of the day.
In Lockhart, Mazoe Ford, 10 News.
Well, let's do some number crunching with Tim Bailey now. Tim, what is the outlook for the flooded areas?
Well, the good news for the Riverina is just a shower or two. In fact, going into a drying pattern, I feel, southeast to southwest winds for the next 3 or 4 days, 23 to 25 degrees, up to around about 26 degrees and sunny for the weekend. So drying periods for the Riverina. The weather story looks like it's going to focus right in on Sydney in the next sort of 10 or 20 hours. We have got a current weather warning for the Sydney metropolitan area, the Illawarra, the Hunter Coast south of Newcastle and the south coast, and that is for heavy rain, flash flooding and dangerous surf. We've got a low that is deepening off the Hunter Coast just south of Newcastle, and as you can see, the rain just starting to fall right across Sydney. It was a windy Wednesday, 82 kilometres an hour at Wattamolla, 71 at Newcastle and 62 across Sydney Harbour. Batten the hatches, 24 hours of wild stuff coming our way.